David Clayson, and I'm very glad to chair our almost the last session of this marvelous conference. We have four wonderful characters and voices for us this morning. Pavel, Jenny, Richard, and Celia. Richard and Celia, I hope, are still on the way. I'm sure you've heard their voices in the conference, and I'm sure you know something about them. But I want to say something else. I want to have you remember the parent organization of these constructionist conferences. You're a logo. And there is a large group symbolized, represented by these four people, of those folk who supported Euro Logo through many years, and that support was both intellectual and emotional. And we must give our thanks to the founders and supporters. There are many of them, but these four people are the ones who represent them to us. So we greet them, and we salute them, and we also thank them. All right, now, it always looks that when we start a session that we have so much time, but you know, when we begin to talk and you begin to talk, the clock ticks. So we have to be careful. I'm going to give them 30 minutes. And you know, Richard and Celia are a duo, so they have 30 minutes too. And what I'd like, I think you might agree, because it's worked so far, I'll hold questions until they're all finished. Because there are always interesting relationships between the papers, and so you can address those to any and all of our speakers. Okay, we'll start with Pavel, and as you probably know, he's a Bulgarian and from the University of Sofia.
Hello, everyone. When I submitted this paper, I never thought it would be accepted. But it got accepted. So in case you're here only for this D, you could come in 12 slides. The first 12 slides, I will not talk about this D. So what I will talk about first is about constructionism in education, then deconstructionism in education, and finally the future of education. But all these are my personal views. So it's not like a collection of what other people have said, it's what I think. I will first start with constructionism in education, my personal experience at university level. There is a long course called Geometry of Motion. It's about using learning geometry and using geometry to model physical motion. And in 2007, I was invited to join the course, so I made a third component about computer science. And the idea was to show how mathematics and physics can be applied in computer animation. And at the beginning, it was just demonstration of how animation is done. But a few years later, I decided to ask the students to make projects, to make virtual mechanisms where they can apply their mathematical and physical knowledge. And it appears that most of the students, more than 92% of them, decided not to make such projects. They were optional projects. And some of the problems were that they had to learn a new programming language, they had to learn how to animate, and I had only 10 astronomical hours to teach this and to ask them to learn this. So last year, in the beginning of this year, I made a new version trying to overcome all the problems which I have observed with the previous version. So I started from scratch. I wrote the same software in another language which was native for the students. This is the language that they have already learned previous years. It's important. The first time you see Scratch, it's small S. And I will show you just three examples of modules made with this language. The first one is called Mixer. Now, this is not a video, it is the actual software, it's a real program. Although this computer is not very multimedia friendly. So you can see you can mix different motions, you can make complex virtual mechanisms. The second one is more complex. So this is actually one device that can draw symmetrical points. If you have two pencils and one draws something, the other draws the opposite. but these are three devices chained next to each other. So you can see here is the first pencil, this is the first projection, the second, here is the third, here is the third one. And the last one, because when they study motion, they think that physical motion, like a table moving along the floor, is easy, but the human walking is very complex. I use the same software to make another model, just to see whether it is possible to animate skeleton in real time, using the software that the students use to create their models. And it appears it's possible. You know from previous conferences, when somebody asks me, is it possible, I always say yes, before waiting to the end of the question. And what are the results? This is something which is not included in the paper, because the results came maybe 2 months ago. The results were that the participation in project making raised from 8% to 57%. So I hope next year I will have a higher score. And on the bottom you can see a model made by a student. It's called harmonograph with 2 different harmonic motions, their combination. You can change, this is actually a video, you can change a lot of parameters here, including the speed, you can slow time or fasten the time. So I hope that it will be much more successful. Another interesting thing is that usually it is only for one speciality, but in this course I had students from 4 specialities. So it was unexpected. There were even students from graduate level, and there was 1 student from outside the university. So the student just wanted to take the course without any scoring, without anything. He was just curious. If I go down to secondary school level, I also have some experience. There are 2 projects, which are complementary projects about inquiry-based learning. And I have no time to explain details about these projects, but they're all about the social and personal inquiry-based learning in education. And there was 1 pilot test, it was maybe 1.5 years ago, during the winter. It was called My Classroom, the Most Energy Efficient One. And students from 6th grade classes have to make competition between different classes, measuring the efficiency of their classrooms, energy efficiency. They could measure temperature, they could measure weather conditions, and all different factors. It lasted about 3 months. And the next year, we had to make again the same experiment. And 1 week before the experiment, we decided that these 3 months are a very long period for students just to take recordings of thermometers and other devices. It was demotivating long for them. It was very hard to repeat an experiment, because during the winter and you have to wait the next winter to repeat the experiment. And it was not possible to change the initial conditions. So 1 week before the second test, they asked me to make a software for the test, like a virtual classroom. It was a standalone application where students can use to make experiments with dual purpose. They could make experiments to collect data, they could make hypotheses, and then they could make new experiments to verify their ideas. So I will sit for a while because I have to control this. This is again not video, but real software. I'm always a risky person. So I will start, maybe I will turn off the sun, the light, maybe a little bit of rain. You see it? Yes, rain. I will let some students, 40 students, sit inside. So there are different devices, like thermometer from the outside. And during making the software, I made 4 very risky decisions. The first one was that the simulation has no beginning, no end. It runs all the time. So it's not possible to set up your configuration, then start the animation, stop it, and record the result. It is running all the time during the setting the parameters. The second decision was that all such devices are analog, not digital. There is also inside. There is a timer, internal temperature, there are air conditioner here. What can I do? Well, I will open the door is open, I will open the windows also. The other risky decision was that all devices are both input and output. For example, I can go outside, I can say that it is, let's say, 40 degrees outside, but it's snowing. You can see, it's snowing. And because the system tries to make equilibrium all the time, you can see the external temperature goes down because of the snow. So you can see here the students, I can put air conditioning on. And the most risky decision was, it was made on purpose without any documentation. So the students had no idea what they can do, how they can navigate, and also the teachers has no documentation. So the only person who knows what's behind this, that's me. And it was risky because we wanted them to investigate and to learn by making experiments. And there are many like Easter eggs. I will try to show you one of them, but don't tell my students this. If you go under the house, you can see skeletons. There are different things. So this is about the house. So what are the results of this? First, we found that the students made trivial discovery functionality, but everyone at his or her own pace. So it was not possible to get everyone to do the same thing at any time. And we also found a lot of scientific contradiction. I mean that, for example, these two pairs here on the left, they made the same configuration and they got the opposite results. They were curious why, and later they found that there are some small details which are very important. And they went to the other side, they started to describe all the details, and then they found that not all details are so important. So they have to learn how to be scientists by experiments. And the jealousy is because some of the students found how to navigate, other students found how to change time. There is a clock on the wall, they can go back and forward. So they started to exchange ideas and exchange knowledge. So this was the second project. And finally, I'm going to deconstructionism in education. I start with something said by Picasso, that every act of creation is first an act of destruction, which I also agree with a small twist, that in my talk, I will use destruction in the meaning of decomposing something into useful parts. So deconstruction is not the same as destruction. And if you look on the web about destructionism, you will find that it is already mentioned there, that it is philosophical theory of criticism. This is not what I'm going to mean by deconstructionism. So what is written there is quite different from what I want to talk about. So if I look at the knowledge and the phases of how knowledge is constructed, on the left is the original knowledge, this red camera. The first phase is what I call the construction phase. This is a student or a person who can deconstruct this into some entities. I will talk later about this. Then is the construction phase, where the student constructs knowledge by himself. And hopefully it is the same knowledge as this one. We are never sure it will be the same one. And finally, there is a third phase about creativity, where the same components are aligned in a different way, so something new is generated. This picture is good, but there are problems in each of these phases. The problem with the last phase, the creativity phase, is because it is optional. In the real classroom, teaching rarely goes up to this point. Usually they finish at second phase. And the problem with the construction phase is that it is celebrity. It gains all the attention and all the effort, and even it has its own conference. It's conference. And finally, the most interesting phase, according to me, the construction phase is unattended, so everyone has to do the construction by himself or herself alone, and there is no real support for this. So, because it is deconstruction, some people think that this is something bad. It is good, it is also a creative process. It is also non-linear, like any creative process. And most of the problems of my students originate in this phase. So if I want to say it very shortly, it is fail to deconstruct, fails deconstruct. It might change this because it sounds, maybe if you translate this in Latin, it will be very profound. If anyone can translate this in Latin, it will be very nice. So this picture here shows that the deconstruction phase, you could deconstruct in different ways, but not every way is useful, because you can construct in one way, and you cannot construct anything from this phase. And usually the problem is that when you deconstruct into something, you then construct it, you fail to construct. And the problem is you don't know whether it's because, like here, the construction is wrong, or whether your deconstruction is wrong. Many students assume they're wrong here. In any case, when I see a student who is stuck with a problem, they are stuck here, in the deconstruction phase. Here is very rare to have someone stuck. And finally, about comparison between constructionism and deconstructionism, I will show you first several ways where I can see deconstructionism exposed to people. It's a kind of manifestations where I can see this. First one is debugging. It is actually deconstruction of a running program. To deconstruct its execution, its data flow. And when I say there are no tools to support deconstruction, someone could say that debuggers, tracers, and there are techniques like breakpoints and watches. But all these tools and techniques are symptomatic. They are not used to discover the bug. They are only used to discover the expression of the bug. Another one is animation design. I have very, very long experience with my students with this. The biggest problem is when they want to model animations in complex motion, they have problems to deconstruct the motion into basic functions so they can recreate by a program this motion. The other side, problem solving, is again manifestation of deconstruction. You deconstruct a problem into smaller parts and then deconstruct a solution from these parts. Or pattern recognition, this is not only the visual pattern recognition, like finding some patterns in chaotic image. It's in the general case. If you see the solution of 20 problems, like computer science problems, you could extract a pattern of how to approach these problems. So this pattern finding is actually deconstruction. So you can deconstruct algorithms and behavior and many other things. And almost the last slide about manifestations is other examples. If you smell something outside at the restaurant, you want to cook it. The only way to make this is to deconstruct the smell with the ingredients and to deconstruct the process of cooking. Reverse engineering is another interesting example of deconstruction. It is pure deconstruction, according to me. And from my personal experience, maybe a decade ago, I started to make a programming language, and instead of going with a full-blown language, like 50 or 100 reserved words, I decided to deconstruct it to the core, to the minimal number of words. So I have made this deconstruction visual, but I have never thought that it is called deconstruction until today, well, until 1 month ago. And there is one more slide which is not present in the paper about other. This is because many students think that a percentage could be from 0 to 100. So I can go above 100, I have no problem. If you look at mathematics, to find the axiom of mathematics, it is deconstruction. And deconstruction is from these axioms to build mathematics. And you can see now the non-linear nature of deconstruction, because mathematics, let's say geometry, because it's more obvious there, can be deconstructed in different sets of axioms, and they produce different geometries. They are all valid, all correct. They are just very different. And if I go to one level above this, and about nature and sizes, deconstruction of nature is actually to split the nature into different sizes, like physics, biology, mathematics. And then the deconstruction phase is to merge it, like biology, physics, like chemistry, computer science. So what is deconstructionism? I will again, because I don't have time, I will just compare them. I have too many slides. So construction is mainly focused on the personal construction of ideas and then public construction of artifacts. Not only tangible artifacts, it could be ideal for the creation, Deconstruction is focused on the understanding of VCT, because you first have to understand them in order to decompose them. And it is about public deconstruction of such artifacts. And having this in mind, deconstructionism is the contre-jour of constructionism. You know contre-jour is when you take picture against the sun. And because of this contre-journess, it's very hard to see the details of the object that you deconstruct. That's why this phase is very difficult, and there are no any tools that can support it, either methodologically or pedagogically or technologically. At least I have not seen such tools. There are tools for the constructionist phase, but not about the deconstructionist phase. And finally, my vision about the future of education is not for you. I will start with an interview of Noam Chomsky. It was maybe 2 years ago, that if you're teaching today what you were teaching 5 years ago, either the field is dead or you are. And he said this about linguistics, but I feel that it is correct for any other educational subject, not only linguistics. That's why I will talk about that education should be changed somehow. I don't know how. The problem that I see is, so far I have never seen sustainably significant results in any change of education. There are good results, but they're like 1 year, 2 years, 3 years long, and then they disappear. We have tried many things, like merging child education and adult education. We take games from child education and make serious games for adults. Adults mean adult education. Not like the other meaning of adult. And we take projects which is nothing for adults and we put into project-based learning. So we have tried different things. And the issue is that education for centuries is incremental, while technology is exponential. So there is no theoretical chance to meet these two things. Something linear and something exponential, they cannot fit together well. They can cross at one point, but then they would diverge after this. And the other problem is that in the past we talked about gaps between generations, and assuming then the future that the students are in different generations, there is a gap between them. But nowadays the problem is that there are technological gaps within a generation. For example, students in first, second grade and students in 10th, 12th grade, they have different idea about technology and different use of technology, conceptually different. So this is something that is not addressed so far. And what I want to see somehow happen is in two phases. The first one is deconstructionism in education, which is something very hard. It is still to be done, but somehow we can imagine it. And the other one is deconstructionism of education, of the education itself, which is something that I still cannot imagine what does it look like. But when we do this, we have immediately to follow it with constructionism. So you make a new education which is not like improved version of the current education, it will be completely new education. But don't ask me what it will be, I have no idea. And the factors which can affect this process, I have tried to reduce them up to three factors. The first one is digitality. Maybe this is not a correct word, but how to say something about digital things. In the past, you know, mathematics was something you work with your hands, and later on, we invented digital mathematics. But it appears that digital has, not appears, it is fact that digital has two meanings. The one is related to numbers, and one is related to fingers. So the old mathematics, I could call it fingerly digital mathematics, and the new one is numerically digital mathematics. And the factor which I want to see is how these two mathematics merge into one. So we have both digital mathematics at the same mathematics. And if you have this, you could move and you could finish the loop. The loop is this. Nowadays you can make something virtually out of our ideas. But in the future, maybe not far future, it is already happening somewhere, it's not common, we could make our ideas into real artifacts, including 3D printers, someone said about this, or other technologies. So it's possible to have something to make virtual object or work with the virtual object, and then make the real object, we can work with the real object, we can do this. The other idea is about ubiquitous learning, which is learning anytime, any place, and I must add with any means. Any means, like you could learn from social media. So it is not only the school, the only institution to learn from. And I have seen you learning, but I have never read about you teaching. And according to me, you teaching should be very important because it's the deconstruction of learning content into a way that it is you learnable. Because making such content is not easy, to make something ubiquitous learnable. And the last factor is about technology itself. It's becoming more transparent, more unobtrusive. In the past, when we want to get some information, we had to go to technology, let's say a library. Yeah. Then we can carry this technology with us, like smartphones and laptops. In the near future, we will wear this technology, like glasses, smart watches, and maybe smartphones, and I don't know. But then we will have the technology in us. I mean, we will directly access what we want to access. So in the past we had most of the innovative things was related to audio classes, then we had video and audio, and I expect that the future will be, this is wrong word, but I cannot find a better word, perceptual. So we will not learn mathematics in the way we learn it today. I always say mathematics, but you could imagine any other subject. We will not learn mathematics, we will experience mathematics. I know this is a little bit risky because if someone is studying history about the Inquisition, it's dangerous to say we experience it. But I think it's clear what I mean. We are not just reading a textbook, repeating something, we will experience with all our senses what we try to learn. So my agenda for my talk was about constructionism, deconstructionism, and the future of education. I think I have covered very quickly all of them. So I'm done with my presentation.
And bravo for your incredible use of English. Really, really lovely. Your life. Bravo. Anyway,
on the
finance.